So let us take the problems, you know, very quickly. We will just try to go through the problems. So now here the problem is like this. It is again a pendulum problem. As we see here, only thing is that a spring is attached. Now that spring, what happens? Let us say assume the length of the spring is very long. Okay, so that is one of the assumptions we will make, and the spring can adjust its position. That means it can vertically come down or go up. So what is this problem? Actually you think like this, that suppose I do not have this weight. If I do not have the weight, then what is happening? It is said the spring is unstressed when theta equals to 30 degrees. So we are neglecting the weight of this bar which is able to rotate about this point. Okay. So spring is unstretched, let us say, at theta equals to 30 degree. Then what happens? We put the weight now. Therefore, what can happen? As you see, 30 degree will be somewhere here. Therefore, the bar is going to reconfigure its position. So that position is said to be equals to theta. Okay. So at theta, now our question is, what value of theta will give me the equilibrium configuration? That is the question here. Okay. So how do I now determine the potential energy of this system of rigid body? So as we see that we can easily choose our datum right here. Okay. So first of all, potential energy has to be determined, and we have to make sure that we have a datum somewhere that is a fixed point, and that fixed point is definitely here. So that will give me, you know, height of this body, and that will be the potential energy of the weight. Then we can get the spring force. So we can look at the how much spring is stretched by coming to the configuration theta. So we can take the spring stretching that way. So it's very simple as such. So just look at the potential energy function now. As I said, this is negative 100 force 10 cosine theta. So 10 cosine theta is the distance from the datum which is chosen at the hinge location. Okay. And negative sign, because now W is, as I said, below the datum line. So therefore, it is a negative sign. Then we have the spring force. The spring energy is given by half multiplied by K. Now what is the stretching? X is the stretching, so that stretching is going to be 5 sin theta, negative 5 sin 30 degree. Okay. Remember, it should have been actually 5 sin 30 degree, negative 5 sin theta, but since we have a square term, it does not matter. So even if we do a plus minus, you know, mistake here, it is not going to hamper the result. But here we have to be very, very careful. When we are looking at the weight, potential energy of the weight or a force, then we have to be extremely careful. Okay. So once the potential energy is done, then we can look at the equilibrium. So dV d theta is given, and the higher order derivative d2b d theta 2 is also given. Now this part is not required, unless otherwise we want to determine the stability of the problem. Okay. So from, we can just look at this part now, because I have to now find theta as a solution. Remember, it is a trigonometric function, and theta cannot be found so easily. So in this way, this one we can simply use some of the root finding methods. For example, we can use Newton-Raphson method to find the root of this function. Let's say this is a function of f theta, then what is the root of the function? So we can use take help of numerical methods, and I am not going to go to that. So basically what I said, that we can really look at the Newton-Raphson method, which is very commonly used. and therefore I will get a solution. That solution is roughly 16 degree. Okay. So the equilibrium configuration is determined by 16 degree, and the stable equilibrium actually comes as a byproduct because we know the theta, and if we have the d2v d theta 2 expression, we just substitute theta, and what it gives me is this value which is greater than 0, therefore it's a stable equilibrium. Clear? So let's move on to the next problem. So just take this problem very quickly and try to understand what it is doing. So all are spring mass type of problem, and we see that, you know, we lot of practical applications that we have, they are actually, we can, you know, simplify those applications into a mass spring system. There are a lot of problems, you will see also those type of problems in tutorials. So here the problem is, I have a 10 kg block that is attached to this rim. So it's a rim or a disc, let's say, and this disc is able to rotate about 0.2. Now you have another disc, but that is firmly connected to the bigger disc. Now on this disc, small disc, I have a spring, okay, that spring is attached to that disc, okay, and remember, unstretched length of the spring is when theta equals to 0. That means when this spring right here, you see this point that is right here, okay, that point we say that spring is unstretched. Now the problem is like this, that I put a weight right here. If I put this weight, then when I am going to achieve the equilibrium configuration? Just think of that way. So at what theta that mass is just going to stabilize, okay? So that is the basically problem. Now remember, in this case steps are again very simple. First we have to determine the potential energy. What are the forces coming into play? One is the weight. I have to derive the potential energy of that. Other one is the spring stretching, right? So that is, we have to find what is the spring stretching. From that we have to get the potential energy. So these are two parts. So let's look at how do I get it, okay? So remember, that's the kind of free body diagram of the problem. So what is the potential energy of the weight? That is simply given by weight multiplied by distance, which is b cosine theta. So I have mg b cosine theta, okay, and then we have the spring stretching. Now spring stretching has to be defined by this arc. So that arc, how much it is stretched, is a multiplied by theta. So that is your s, okay. So ultimately what is happening, that you have half k a theta squared, that's the stretching of the spring. Clear? So now problem is really math. So we'll just go to the math. I am going to, you know, go quickly. So what is happening? If you do dv d theta equals to 0, I am definitely going to get two configurations. One would be theta equals to 0, as you see here, and another one is defined by this, okay, which will give me theta equals to 51.7 degree. So there are two equilibrium configurations possible, right? Now question is, if I go to the higher order, which one will give me the stable solution? So again we need to do d2v d theta 2, and for theta equals to 0, you see that is what I am going to get, d2v d theta 2. For theta equals to 0, it is going to be negative, so that is less than 0, therefore it's an unstable equilibrium configuration, okay, and for theta equals to 51.7 degree, I am going to get an stable equilibrium configuration. And it's very natural also, because what happens, spring was unstretched, you put the mass, it is trying to go to the, you know, stable condition by rotating by some amount. So that rotation amount is 51.7 degree, and that's going to be the stable configuration. So another problem, now this will happen in the buckling case. Now what is it? We have two vertical bars. These two bars are attached to a single spring here. Remember, I have a pin here, okay, and I have a pin here. So therefore, these two bars can rotate, okay, and the spring is connected at this point C. And one more thing importantly observe that there is a roller that's called guided roller. Again, what it will do, it will only allow the motion in the vertical direction. There is no motion in the horizontal direction. Now, what is the main question here is to determine the range of values of P for which the equilibrium of the system is stable in the position shown. So, remember in this problem, what will happen? The stable equilibrium will be completely determined by the value of K. How much load I can put in, that will be completely dependent on the value of K and the geometry of the problem. So, idea is that for some values of P, the system is going to be unstable. But as you go beyond that value of P, then system is going to be unstable. So, it is a completely buckling problem. So, the value of P for the stable equilibrium is determined by the value of K and the geometry of the problem. Is that clear? So, if you look at this way, then what is happening? First of all, remember I have to now disturb the system by a small amount theta and try to see that disturbance theta, right, whether it is going to give me the stable equilibrium or unstable equilibrium. Okay. In other words, therefore, I have to now rotate the system. So, I am going to do that. So, therefore, what is happening? First, we give it a disturbance small theta, let us say. So, if this is theta, then due to geometry, let us say this is phi. Now, theta and phi will have again a relationship that involves the geometry of the problem. Okay. So, what is that relationship? We know that A sin theta must be equals to 2a sin phi. Now, if theta and phi are small, right, then phi should be equals to theta by 2. Therefore, now we have to determine the potential energy. So, how do we determine the potential energy of this force? Again, this force will be treated as same as a body weight almost, because as you can see, this force will not change the direction. So, its potential energy again will be always determined by the position of it. So, it is acting almost like a body weight, right, and the potential energy will simply be given by P multiplied by this entire distance, that is y a. So, this is the datum we have to choose. Okay. So, therefore, what I have for the spring also, what is the stretched configuration? That is negative a sin theta. Okay. So, total potential energy becomes half k multiplied by spring stretching square, that is a sin theta square, plus I have the potential energy of the force P. Okay. Remember, body weight is ignored in this case of these bars. So, I have only this force and the stretching of the spring. Now, as you can see, if you look at this potential energy function and if you do dV by d theta, what does it give? So, dV by d theta will lead to a solution for theta. As you can see, theta equals to 0 is a solution. And which is the position that is shown? So, the equilibrium configuration is determined by theta equals to 0. So, theta equals to 0 is a possible equilibrium configuration. So, what we are asked, now you have to find the P on that configuration such that it is a stable system. What should be the range of values of P such that it is stable at theta equals to 0? So, that was the question. Okay. So, now we just say that d2v d theta 2, therefore, we take this d2v d theta 2 expression and we set greater than 0 for stable equilibrium, right. So, therefore, we can see that if we do this operation at theta equals to 0 of this expression right here, then we are going to get P less than 4/7 kA. Very nice problem to think about. As I said, now below this number 4/7 kA, right, then we are going to get a stable equilibrium configuration. That means, in buckling problem, we always try to study this problem in terms of buckling. If you give it a small lateral disturbance, if your P is really less than 4/7 kA, right, then it is going to come back. So it is not going to go other way, right? So that's the stable equilibrium configuration. And therefore, now this problem really brings in the essence of buckling. Okay. Now, if you really P equals to 4 by 7 Ka, that is the limit of it. After that, if you increase the load, system is simply going to collapse. Okay, so it is going to get to some other equilibrium configuration, so it's going to be highly unstable. It is simply going to deform sideways. Okay. So another very nice problem we will just study. Now this problem is going to be quite, you know, intriguing for the students as well. As we can see here, what is this problem state is that, let's say you have a rectangular uniform solid body of mass m and height h that is resting on a fixed cylinder with a semicircular section. So this is a fixed cylinder. What we have to do? Set up a criteria for stable and unstable equilibrium for the rectangular body in terms of h and r for the position shown. So it is completely determined by the geometry of the problem. Remember, this body has its OS which is passing through the mass center. Right? Now, if you disturb the system a little bit, question is what condition should prevail between H and R such that the body can come back to its original configuration? Very nice problem to look at. The main part here will be, as I said, that always how do I get the potential energy function correctly? If we get the potential energy correctly, then we can solve these problems very, very easily. So just look at it. As I said, let us assume that this is an equilibrium configuration. I disturb the system by an amount theta. Okay. So what I will do in the next slide, you can see here that body is tilted. So therefore, the mass center that was at the middle of the rectangular block, that is also going to be shifted to a new position. All right. So that new position is now say O. The question is, what is that new height of the mass center from the datum? So we have chosen the datum as dd prime. So it is again completely geometry that will control. Now how I am going to get that adjusted height, the final height of the center where the weight is passing through, what is that height? How do I calculate it? Remember, there is a little kinematics involved. Remember, as I rotate the rectangular body from its original configuration, this translational component that you see here, right, that is equal to the arc. So this arc length is equals to that BB prime, okay, or AB. Let's say AB. AB is equals to really the arc length. So that is the only thing that we have to keep in mind. Okay? Because, so it is a curvilinear here. The curved is actually curvilinear motion become a rectilinear motion here. Okay? So now you see here that what is the total, you know, height of the position now of the mass center. So we'll go step by step. Firstly, remember OA, OA is still going to be H over 2. Now, what is my AB? AB is equals to, as I said, you have to now look at the arc length. So, arc length is R theta. So, finally, what we have? The total height, if we look at the vertical height, so CB cosine theta plus AB sine theta plus OA cosine theta. Okay, so that's the total height. So you can get the, you know, potential energy mg multiplied by the height. Now rest is very simple. So as long as I understand how to get the potential energy for a rotation of theta, then I can do the other steps in a very simple way as we have been doing. So rest is math. So dv d theta equals to 0 indeed is giving me theta equals to 0 as an equilibrium position. So theta equals to 0 was indeed an equilibrium configuration. And then we do d 2 v d theta 2, right? So, d 2 v d theta 2, now we have to say that for theta equals to 0, we get this expression for d 2 v d theta 2. That will be greater than 0 for r to be greater than h over 2. So, that means the stable equilibrium condition will prevail when r is greater than h over 2. Okay. And for unstable equilibrium, d 2 v d theta 2 should be less than 0. So, r must be less than h over 2. So, idea is depending on what we have, whether r greater than h over 2 or r less than h over 2, if I disturb the rectangular body, it is either going to come back to its original configuration or it is simply going to go to, you know, just slide down. That means it is going to go to an unstable mode. So, either it will be stable equilibrium or unstable depending on the relationship between r and h. Okay. So, I will just close the, you know, lecture problems. So, we have studied, you know, quite a few problems that actually, you know, encounter in real life examples, and you will see that more in tutorial problems. But main idea that we attempt to, you know, deliver is the fact that can I get the potential energy expression correctly? Can I understand the potential energy? And once I have the potential energy function, I can now find out what is the equilibrium configuration and whether the equilibrium configuration is stable or not. Okay. So, I will just take the discussions now and then we can go for tutorials quickly.
We have principle for minimum potential energy. What about any principle relating to other forms of energy?
There are, you know, other form of energy theorem is available. For example, you know, we can see the Castigliano's theorem also. Okay. So, you will see that when we have a deformable bodies, for the deformable bodies, we can take those kind of principles also. But when it is a rigid body, mostly we talk about, you know, kinetic energy as well as the potential energy. So, here I do not have a dynamic problem, but if once the dynamic problem comes into play, then we will have some of this energy, right, that will be always conserved. That is, potential energy plus kinetic energy will be always conserved. But for the rigid bodies, in this course, engineering mechanics course, we are only going to limit ourselves kinetic energy and the potential.
Sir, as you explained in the problems, there are zero force members in the truss. In practical, is it necessary to provide this type of the member, or can we avoid this type of the member to save the cost or economy?
Your question is again coming back to zero force member in a truss, and what we tried to tell repeatedly that as a designer, I design a truss. Remember, zero force member is happening due to special loading conditions. Suppose I have a set of loading on the structure, some member may go to zero force. But remember, if I change my loading pattern, those members may not be zero force. As a designer, I look at all possible combinations of the forces that make the structure safe, right? All combination of external loading that is going to make the structure safe. In that way, when I am really designing the problem, I do not have any zero force member. Okay. So, all the members needs to be
sir,
put.
But actually, in railway bridges, we have seen that there are number of the…
For that particular loading. That particular loading state, you may not be willing to put those members, fine enough. But remember, if some other loading comes into play, then the structure will collapse, right? Because I do not have actually those members in the truss. So, therefore, I have to put those members on the truss. Okay? So, zero force member is just a, you know, depending on how the load is acting on the truss. Is that clear now? And no matter what, you can always send your, you know, a question by email. You have my personal email, send the question. I am able to respond to many people who are sending me questions. Okay. In fact, the zero force member I also, you know, answered by email.
Okay, thank you.
There is one question coming up related to the non-conservative force. Although that's not a point of discussion, but remember, for the non-conservative force, I said the friction force is one form of non-conservative force, and it is true actually, because you know that friction problem, okay, the friction force can change its direction as the body goes from one point to the other point, because the trajectory is very important. Friction force is always going to be tangent to the path, right? It is always going to be tangent to the path. Therefore, what happens? The force is actually changing its direction as it is moving from one point to the other point. Therefore, the definition of potential, as we started this session, the definition of potential comes from the fact when the work done is independent of the path followed. Now, if the force is following the path, that is, it is keep on changing the direction, then work done for each and every, you know, distance it travels going to be different. Okay, so we cannot define potential for such forces. Is that clear now?
1112.
Sir, it is said the potential energy depends on the position of the body. That means it. So if a body weighs mg and if it is at a height of h, the energy that will be applied, it will be mgh.
That's correct. That is what we have done.
Am I correct, sir?
Yes.
What are the things that should be considered in resolving a problem?
See, what we are considering mostly the sign of the potential energy. Mgh is the potential energy of the body with respect to the weight. Weight means gravitational force. So, gravitational force is what is the force there. What is important to understand? So, just think this way, that I have a datum somewhere here, okay, and I lift this pen. So, body weight of this pen is acting downward, right, and height is h. So, potential energy is positive. Now, if I put the pen down here and this is my datum still, then what is the potential energy? It is negative. So, only thing that we have to be careful is the sign of it, nothing else. Only thing we will be caring about sign of it, okay, depending on where we choose the datum, okay.
1182.
Hello sir, how to take datum line and how we can recite the datum line? Is it possible stable or unstable by taking double derivative? Why there is need to take double derivative?
Okay, the question is how to choose the datum line. Okay, that question is more appropriate, and I am going to discuss this. Okay, how to choose the datum line? I said during the problem, the datum line should be something that is fixed on the space. That means if the body is moving, datum line should not move. That's the first thing. Okay, so now let me just try to explain it quickly. Okay, so remember, let's say this is the bar L, it has its weight at its mass center, okay? As the body moves, okay, now when we are talking about this fixed datum, why I am choosing right here? Remember, this height, if I choose the datum here, then y can be expressed in terms of theta, right? Let's say this is L is the total height. Let's say this is L over 2. So, this is L over 2 here and this is also L over 2. So, ultimately y should be equals to, in this case, L over 2 cosine theta. Now, remember, suppose I choose somewhere here, does not matter, and I know this height is h. So, in the potential energy expression, in this case, what I have, V equals to WY, so W L over 2 cosine theta. Whereas in this case Y equals to L over 2 cosine theta plus H. Okay? So V equals to W L over 2 cosine theta plus H. Now remember, as I said, potential energy is not an absolute parameter, it is relative. So relative to the datum that you choose. So this is datum 1, this is datum 2. But I am only concerned about getting the equilibrium configuration. Therefore, I am to make dV by d theta equals to 0. Remember, when I do dV d theta, H is independent of theta, right? So therefore, dV d theta term will not have anything to do with the H. It will simply disappear because that's a constant term. So in this type of problems, you can choose datum anywhere you want to. But remember, the position of this mass, position of this, you know, force, gravitational force, is always defined in terms of theta, or in a some other problem it is x. Okay? So as long as that is true, it does not matter if you just add a height h, which is just a constant term. But this datum has to be always fixed axis. It should not change its position as the body moves or as the body tilts. Okay? So h can be, you know, that h is a constant height. So that will not factor into your solution that you are trying to establish.
Why there is need to take double derivative for stable and unstable equilibrium, sir?
Your question is going back to theory that we have explained. Why do you need to take double derivative to make sure it is stable or unstable? Why I am doing it? Because if you look at it, what is dV d theta? What is dV d theta in physical sense? Just tell me that first. It is the slope, right? Remember, you have a potential energy function, right? Potential energy function you have drawn, it has a slope. Wherever slope is 0, that is the equilibrium configuration, right? And then we are going to one order up. Why? Because now we are concerned about curvature. So ideally, think of a ball. See, if you have a, you know, surface like this, let's say this is an arc, okay? This is really V theta function. Now, what we have discussed really is that the slope of it, if you keep on calculating slope everywhere, you get slope equals to 0, right, at this point. So that is definitely going to be equilibrium. Question is, why it is stable or unstable? Think of putting a ball. Now, if I move this ball right here, can I come back to its original configuration? That's the question. If it is so, if the ball can come back to its original configuration, then it's a stable configuration. Now, how do I decide this? It will be decided based on the curvature that the V, right, that is taking place. Now you are concerned about what is the curvature rho. The curvature is defined by what? Rho equals to always d2V d theta 2. So ultimately this brings in the concept of curvature. If the curvature is greater than 0, then it will be stable. So that means this is a math problem, that means that will define the minimum potential energy, right? If the curvature is less than 0, that will define the maximum potential energy. Okay? So this will be always minimum potential energy, and this state here will be maximum potential. Okay? Is that clear now? So it is completely determined by whether this shape is concave or whether this shape is convex, nothing else. Okay? And it is a complete mathematical, you know, model that we use. Even class 12 standard has the same you know, thing. But you talk about in math, but it is more in physical sense now.
1179.
Suppose if you are considering a motion of a body in an inclined surface without any rolling, how can you find out this minimum and maximum condition, whether it is stable or unstable?
If it is rolling, it will be always, no, it, that depends on what kind of forces it has, right? Actually, we do have a problem in the tutorial, but I will give more that as a homework. Your question is if the body is moving on an inclined surface, okay, and that's a more complex problem to discuss. But the problem that I will try to give it in the homework would be as follows. Suppose I have a ball, okay. Now this ball has its own weight W. Now I put another small mass here, so that mass is, let's say, M. Can you tell me whether this equilibrium is stable or unstable? So what condition should prevail between this W and M such that I can say the equilibrium is stable or unstable? This kind of problem can be studied, okay? So this will give it in the homework, and we can just brainstorm that when should I get the stable or unstable configuration.
1263.
When we are choosing the problem stated as a potential energy or the work energy method?
Your question is when do we use potential energy, when we use work energy? Two are completely different. See, potential energy is being used for the rigid body problems. But work energy principle that we see, right? Remember, it can also get into the deformable bodies, when the body is actually deforming. Okay. Now, in rigid body aspects, work energy principle also comes into play, but mostly work energy principle, when you see it, you will see it in terms of deformable bodies, because deformable body has to now do work in terms of strain energy. So, we call that strain energy. Okay. So, then we say work energy principle is coming into that. But here everything is rigid body, so that is not coming at all, okay?
Sir, I want to know that Castiglione's theorem or strain energy may be at all be thought as an advanced version of this virtual work theory or minimum potential energy theory?
Absolutely correct. You are absolutely correct. Your question is Castiglione's theorem. Whether Castiglione's theorems can be considered as more advanced version. But tell me, when do we get the Castiglione's theorem? Again, you are going back to deformable bodies. When the body is actually undergoing a deformation. For example, see, this is again not the scope of work, but the question came like this, Castiglione's theorem. See, remember, typically what we do, let's say you have a fixed beam, I apply the load. Now what happens? The body actually deforms. The body will actually deform. So what will happen? Now all the, you know, if you look at all the particles, that particles are actually doing a work by stretching themselves, right? Okay. So we write, therefore, what happens once you apply the load, the strain energy is stored on the body in terms of the deformation of the fibers or particles. Okay. So, Castiglione's theorem, if you look at it, you will see that we define a strain energy, okay, that will be integral of half there will be EI term coming into play. But see, remember what happens in these cases, this is completely departure from the rigid body mechanics. Why it is so? Because at the first hand, I am assuming the body is actually deforming, which is not the case of a rigid body. So therefore, in terms of rigid body, this body has only potential in terms of this force applied. It does not have the strain energy that is coming into play when the body is actually deforming. Is that clear? Now, in more advanced mechanics, we actually look at Hamilton's principle. In Hamilton's principle, we say that the total energy, which will be composed of strain energy plus potential energy plus kinetic energy, there will be three terms. Okay? So, all of these three terms, now I have to minimize that function. So, we will choose a, you know, Hamilton's principle is more general, that is the most general concept, and I will just give you this task to look at homework. Okay? This is most general. But remember, this concept is introduced when we look at mostly deformable bodies. A deformable bodies should have strain energy stored, okay, because this body is doing some work, right? This force is doing some work due to the application of P, and that will store the, you know, energy, additional energy in terms of strain energy. Is that clear now? But it is, yes, it is more advanced.